Dude. I figured it out. I finally figured it out. The best sleep hack there is. This, it's a game changer, this one.
What? You did?
Holy shit. Finally.
It's early eating, isn't it?
Making your room exactly 62 degrees. Try again.
Wow. Blue light blockers.
Nah, bro, this is some next level shit.
All right, then come on, what is it?
You ready?
Bam.
Yo, what is up? Welcome back to another week of How to Health. My name is Kevin, I run liftandbalance.com, where we take aim at all things health and do it in an odd, weird, interesting, and highly sarcastic manner. Today, we are going to start with a question for you. Yeah, you right there. I see you. Nice place. Like what you done with it. Homey, hip, cool, nice vibe. Moving on. If you had to dedicate one third of your life to a certain activity, and this activity happened to have a direct relationship with your day-to-day mood and function, would you try and make this mandatory time well spent and enjoyable? Or would you say screw it and wing it? Tough question, right, production team?
This is hard!
Well, let me fill you in on a little secret here. This make-believe scenario is real. In fact, very real. It's sleep, and it is biologically mandatory. No questions asked. And here's the deal. You can either use this mandatory function to your advantage or let it impair ever so slightly or drastically your day-to-day function and thus your life. So I'm here to talk about why you should choose option one and talk about the four ways that I have structured my sleep to be obtaining nearly 3 hours of deep sleep per night. And you may be thinking, deep sleep? The hell is that? Excellent question. So in the next 14 minutes and 57 seconds, we will be running through what deep sleep is, why you should care, and my four ways to harness and optimize its power. Side note, random thought, how do we know this isn't, you know, all a dream right now? First, a crash course in deep sleep. Depending on what scientists you ask, we either have 4 or 5 stages of sleep. And for this video, we'll stick with 4 because, you know, it's less counting. Each and every night, we have between 4 and 6 90-minute-ish sleep cycles. Sleep cycle being the time it takes to get through all the disparate stages of sleep. Stages 1 through 3 are known as non-REM, or non-dreaming sleep, while stage 4 is known as REM, or dreaming sleep. And we can spend hours going through all the awesomely cool functions of these stages. And you can see a lot of that information in the How to Sleep playlist up here. But for this conversation today, we are going to focus on stage 3 non-REM sleep. This stage right here is classified as deep sleep, or where the neuronal activity in our brain enters a meditation-like state. A slow chant of electrical waves. A time where we get to finally exit that overstimulation of the modern world and recover. Non-REM deep sleep is the period of time where the majority of the restoration, rejuvenation, regeneration, and detoxification happens in our body. Where we rebuild our body, strengthen the immune system, consolidate memory, and clean out our brain. Which is so cool, it gets its own video. Now, from cycle to cycle, as we move through the night, the time allocation between REM and non-REM shifts. We typically start out with a higher percentage of non-REM in the early part of the night and shift to more of a REM-heavy or dreaming-heavy sleep later in the night. And experts estimate that a healthy night of sleep looks kind of like this. About 20% of the night dedicated to stage 3 non-REM deep sleep, about 25% of the night dedicated to REM or dreaming sleep, and the other 50% is spent in stage 1 and 2 non-REM, otherwise known as light sleep. All that being said, this ideal allocation doesn't just happen. In fact, it is shown to be easily disrupted. And our modern day habits, along with societal norms, have the majority of us humans walking around in a compromised cellular and metabolic state each and every day. And that ain't cool. So after years of tracking and optimizing my sleep, these are my 4 top tips to optimize that oh so important deep sleep. Number 1, timing. When you wake up and go to bed. We humans happen to have these natural rhythms that coordinate with the sun rising and falling each and every day. These are deep, innate biological pressures that have evolved with us humans and life in general for hundreds of thousands and millions of years, which makes them kind of a big deal. These are our circadian rhythms. And this internal body clock sets off a series of biochemical signals throughout our body when it receives internal or external cues, upregulating and downregulating different gene activity and processes accordingly. So the best way to guarantee a good night's sleep each and every night is to keep that internal body clock in sync. And you do this by having a consistent wake time and sleep time each and every day. And yes, even on the weekends, pushing it no further than 30 minutes in either direction. Here's one of the key points that I want to get across. When you're looking to optimize sleep quality, timing matters. The optimal hours for deep sleep are between 8 p.m. and 3 a.m., while the optimal hours for REM are between 3 a.m. and 9 a.m. This is not to say that you won't get these critical stages of sleep. If your schedule looks something along the lines of 4 a.m. to 12 p.m., you will, because they're mandatory for survival, but you most definitely will not be maximizing and optimizing them. And I can confidently say that focusing on consistency here has been a game changer for my sleep. And when that thing called life happens and you end up staying up later than you would normally like to, the next morning, get up at the same time and get right back on track. You'd be surprised how 2 days or a weekend of inconsistent sporadic sleep can affect the body, which we break down here. Next, we move to meal timing. And this has been one of my most eye-opening observations and one that I've took to a little bit of what you can say an extreme. Let me explain. Contrary to popular belief, and despite what you might hear from all the fitfluencers out on the interwebs, meal timing matters, particularly when it comes to sleep. You may not have an issue falling asleep on a full stomach, but the research suggests that sleep quality, in particular deep sleep, is impaired. And I've seen this in my personal data, which has driven me to implement an early time-restricted feeding protocol, which I've been doing and enjoying for the last couple of years. And we break it down all in this video here. Little background. Throughout 2019, I followed an already sleep-friendly 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. 18-6 feeding protocol, then transitioned to early OMAD or one meal a day in 2020, eating between the hours of 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. That was the tad bit extreme that I was talking about before. And interestingly enough, I saw a 15% bump in deep sleep time a few months after the transition, adding to the already impressive numbers. And unfortunately, I got into early fasting before I got into tracking sleep, so I don't have any long-term sleep data from my pre-early eating days. But what I can say is, on the days that life has me eating later than I typically would, the data looks something like this. Yeah. So why is this? Well, digestion is a pretty heavy-duty task for the body. It requires a large amount of energy and many systems' attention for quite some time after we finish eating. On average, 4 to 6 hours. This concentrates blood flow to the intestines and increases core body temperature, which we want to go in the other direction for optimal sleep quality. While doing this, it also takes away blood flow from other vital systems. And this normally wouldn't be a bad thing unless it was eating into, pun intended, the designated rebuild, regenerate, detox functions that need to happen each and every night. Big meals before bed impair all of this, drastically impacting deep sleep and stealing time away from things such as our nightly brain clean, or when our brain cleans out all that neurotoxic waste that accumulates as a byproduct of being awake. And impairing said cleanup is thought to be one of the leading causes of plaque accumulation and neurodegenerative disease down the line. Yeah. Not cool. And if you're looking for more on this topic, I have a full meal timing deep dive that I will link below. Then we move on to the critical 1 to 2 hours before bed. My sleep hygiene routine. How you spend that last hour or two before bed can be the difference between a poor to average night's sleep and a great one. This right here is a critical decompress period that can make sleep onset rather easy or feel impossible. And I cannot stress routine and consistency enough here. Here's what I've found success doing. First, T-minus 1 hour before bed. Remove and turn off all technology. Phones, laptops, TVs, tablets, the whole kit and caboodle. And this is for two main reasons. First, scrolling feeds, news, social media, gaming is, whether you know it or not, psychologically and emotionally stressing. This can keep our mind buzzing quite some time after we put the devices down. So to optimize sleep onset, give yourself a tech-free final hour. To hedge my bets, I turn my phone on airplane mode 1 hour before bed and do not turn it back on until I've finished my morning routine. And if you want to see how to hack your morning, we got a full video on that too. And I get it. It's a lot easier said than done. So work your way there, shutting down 10 to 15 minutes earlier each and every week or each and every night until you get to that desired shutdown time. The second reason to ditch the tech is the light. These devices emit blue light, which can get interpreted by our eyes and our brain as sunlight and delay the secretion of our critical sleep hormone, melatonin. Thus, detaching from tech is a critical part that I've found success with for my nightly routine. I know it's not a fan favorite, but trust me, it will do a much, much, much more good than harm. And sleep onset, or the time it takes for me to go to bed once I'm in bed, something that I have struggled with for the majority of my life, has drastically improved. And little known hack here too, many of our phones and electronic devices actually have a blue light mode or a way to warm the temperature on the screen to make it easier on the eyes. So you can set these automatically. So set them, set it, forget it. The tech is there, use it. And on the topic of light, another thing that I try to reduce as much as possible is the overhead LED light and replace them for a table light, lamp, or something of that nature. This right here will also help decrease any melatonin blockage. And no night is complete until I throw on my snazzy blue light blockers approximately 2 hours before bed. This right here also helps me mitigate my artificial light risk as much as possible. Lastly, I round out my routine by making sure my room is cool, hovering somewhere between 60 and 65 degrees Fahrenheit. This right here is the optimal temperature for sleep onset. Remember, we want that core body temperature to decrease, and having a cooler room helps along with this effort. And if the day has been overly stressful, a little breathing exercise or meditation helps get me back into a parasympathetic rest or digest nervous system state, the optimal state for rest and recovery. Again, can't stress enough, consistency here is your best friend. A solid bedtime decompress routine can work wonders for deep sleep. And keep those common disruptors at bay. What disruptors? Limit the late night disruptors. There are a few things that we know have hindering effects on our sleep, specifically when performed later in the evening. So these are three things I strategically avoid at night. Number one, booze. Alcohol, alcohol, alcohol. I'll say this, it kicks sleep in the figurative nuts. Everyone's threshold is a little different, but it has shown to be dramatically impacting on both deep sleep and dreaming sleep. Yes, you may lose consciousness faster, but that most certainly does not mean you're getting good sleep. In fact, the data shows the opposite, with one spending most of their time in stage 1 and 2 light sleep. Oh, and you know, like hangovers suck too, and will probably put you in a crappy biochemical state for the next 1 to 3 days. I don't know about you, but that's not something I'm willing to do often after experiencing how awesome a good night of sleep makes me feel. Then we move to everyone's other favorite pick-me-up, caffeine. Hitting all the fun ones today, huh? Here's the deal. Caffeine has a half-life of 5 hours, meaning it takes 5 hours for half of the caffeine that you ingest to exit your system. And it has shown to do two detrimental things to our sleep. First, delay sleep onset, and second, impair sleep quality, particularly deep sleep. So this is something I am very strategic with, and stop all caffeine consumption T-minus 10 hours before bedtime. The last thing I personally keep in check is late night intense exercise. If you know me, you know I love a good sweat. Half of my videos on this YouTube channel are about sweating and sweating intensely. I will never tell you not to get your sweat on. The benefits that it brings to the table are second to none, except for maybe sleep. So I make sure I finish up my intense exercise 4 to 5 hours before bed. Light walks don't count here. I am talking about heat-inducing, sweat-generating burns. Whew, getting hot in here. This is because intense exercise does a number of sleep-disrupting things. It increases core body temperature dramatically, which can delay sleep onset. It also stimulates the sympathetic nervous system, or our fight or flight nervous system, which puts our body in a more stressed out state, increasing heart rate variability, and the secretion of stress hormones, all of which we ideally want to decrease for sleep onset and sleep quality. In addition to all this, it has been shown to delay the secretion of our sleep hormone, melatonin, which we kind of need. Now, remember, all of this is not bad unless you're trying to go to sleep a half an hour when you get home from the gym. And in the 2 years that I've been tracking my sleep each and every night with the Oura Ring, I've clearly observed decreased sleep quality following late night exercise within 3 to 4 hours of bed. Just a few things to keep in mind. And that's what I got. Following these strategies have allowed me to consistently achieve high deep sleep times over the last few years and helped me feel refreshed, restored, and rejuvenated each and every day. And as you can see, it doesn't just happen. Just like anything else in this world, it takes a little bit of work. But I mean, if you're gonna spend 1/3 of your life doing something, you might as well do it well. Oh yeah, don't forget your dream catcher. Keeps the monsters away.